Well, hi, I'm Carl. Welcome back to the 9000. This is another video in my series on my flipdot display panel that I got from eBay and my homemade Arduino controller on the back here. This episode is called Letting the Smoke Out and How Not to Do That. It's something I've done a few times on this project already, and let me tell you, it's terrifying. My biggest fear is that I will do something that damages the flipdot panel here, because this is the only one I've got and I can't get another one. They don't make them anymore. I have been lucky so far in that although I have literally let the smoke out a few times on my circuit boards here, all the damage was confined only to my own circuit boards here. So I was able to track down the bad chips and replace them, and I can keep going. And so this video is about a couple of things you can do in a circuit to prevent that from happening. I've got a simplified schematic diagram here of what's on the boards. You'll recall there's an Arduino Nano that controls it all. And it speaks serial to some shift registers here using the SPI or serial peripheral interface hardware that's built into the Nano here. So there's a chain of shift registers for the rows and a chain of shift registers for the columns. I've only drawn one of each, but there's a whole bunch that are daisy chained together here. And if you recall from earlier, these shift registers are open collector outputs. These are TI6B595 shift registers. And open collector means that the final output transistor on each bit there can turn on, in which case it can pull the output down to zero, down to ground, or it can be turned off, in which case the output just floats. There's nothing in the shift register that actively pulls it up high. If I want to pull it up high, I've got to have an external pullup resistor out there. And you'll also recall that there's two bits for every line here. Because I don't just need two states, I really need three states. I need to drive it high or drive it low or just turn it off. And so I've got a little truth table here of how you drive it to the different states here. So if I were to shift in a zero and a zero here, that would turn off both transistors. There's no low side drive. There'd be no, this would not be actively pulled low. The pull-up resistor is going to pull that high. Not shown here is the high side driver transistor. That would turn on, and that's my high state. If I shift a 1 and a 1, both these output transistors here are going to turn on. That's going to give me my low side drive. This is going to get pulled low, and that's going to turn off that high side transistor. So that's my low state. If I shift in a 1 and a 0, I'm going to end up turning off both the low side drive and turning off the high side drive. That's my off state. The final state is the one you got to watch out for. That's a 0 and a 1. That would turn on the low side drive. The zero here would allow the pull-up resistor to pull that up high. That would turn on the high side drive, and now I'm shorting the power supply. You really never want to do that. Now, the cure for that is just that little diode in there. What that ensures is that whenever the low side is active, it's also going to pull down the high side with it. And that prevents that pull-up resistor from pulling that up and ever turning on the high side drive. So effectively, that converts this bad condition simply into another low output state here. And now you might think, you know, if you're a careful programmer, surely you could write correct code and you would never inadvertently shift a 0-1 when you intended to shift something else. But there's some complications that come with SPI that make that a little more likely than you might think. SPI is a generic kind of protocol to talk to all kinds of different serial devices here. When you've got a serial device, you're going to have a data line here with your ones and zeros data bits that you're shifting. And you're also going to have a clock line, and the transitions are going to occur on an edge transition on the clock. But different devices are going to have are going to want to see a different transition on that clock line. Some devices want a low to high transition, like these 595s do. There's other devices you can get that will shift a bit on a high to low transition. And then furthermore, there's what do you do with the clock line when you're not actively shifting data? Does it go low or does it go high? So if you're so at SPI, you have to make two choices there. Do I transition a bit on a low to high or on a high to low? And then when I'm not shifting anything, does the clock line go low or does it go high? So that's four possibilities. Whenever you do an SPI transfer, you've got to set the mode. Which of those four possibilities am I interested in? And so let's think about what could happen if you set the wrong mode. If you think you're shifting out 8 bits or 16 bits or 32 bits at a time, but the device you're talking to has a different idea of what direction that clock bit, which clock edge it's going to pay attention to. You could easily fool this thing into thinking it saw maybe one fewer transition than you think you sent, or maybe this thing would think it saw one more transition than what you think you sent. And so what happens when what you're trying to do is shift a whole chain of 1 0 1 0 1 0 because I want to turn everything off, but the shift register saw one fewer bit than you actually sent. That's going to turn it into 0 1 0 1 0 1, and so that is the bad state. So it really is essential that you have that diode in there to prevent that from ever happening. It doesn't cost very much. It doesn't take a lot of room on the circuit board. It's only pennies, so it's completely worth having that. And later on, I'm going to show on the bench what happens when that diode's not there and how putting that diode back in fixes things. And now the second way that you can get into trouble, and that I have let the smoke out on this board, is if you leave the coil energized too long. It only takes about 200 microseconds in order to flip the dot from one direction to the other. And so there's no reason to leave it turned on any longer than that. If you do, the coil is just going to saturate, it's going to become a short circuit, and then you're going to be drawing a huge amount of current through the driver chips, and you're going to let the smoke out. And again, you might think, well, you know, I can write some correct code that surely would never do that. But you've got to consider these are shift registers. You're going to program a state into them, shift some bits into them, and then the outputs hold that until you shift something else in there. So what the code does is it'll figure out which dots it's got to flip. Do I need rows high and columns low, or vice versa? Send out those data bits, and then it's going to go into a delay loop for 200 microseconds, and then it's going to shift out an off condition to turn everything back off. And the way you get in trouble is, what if something comes along and causes that nano to want to do something else while it's in the middle of that delay loop? What if you come along and press the reset button? Well, pressing the reset button isn't too big a deal. Because as you know, at the beginning of every Arduino sketch, you're going to configure all your GPIO lines. Your GPIOs can be either inputs or outputs, and you're going to decide which is which, right? Usually right the very first thing you do in the code. And that's of course what my code does too. These are all configured as outputs. None of them need to be inputs. So right at the top of the code, I set all these different lines to outputs, and I set initial state here, and everything's fine. But of course, that's not the only thing. You know, pressing the reset button is not the only thing that causes a reset. If you want to update your code from the Arduino IDE, and you click the menu option, upload my code, it communicates over USB, and what it does is it causes a reset on the Nano. When you do a reset, the bootloader gets control, and the bootloader's job is first to figure out, did this reset happen because the host controller is trying to reprogram me? If the answer is no, then it just begins executing the code in the flash, and of course that first thing it's going to do is configure all my GPIOs and make sure I'm in a safe state. But if you actually were trying to reprogram at that point, then it's going to receive that bitstream over the serial port, and it's going to update the flash, and only then is it going to start executing the new code. Well, that takes a considerable amount of time, and if I had turned on some solenoids here, and while I was in my 200 microsecond delay loop, tried to reprogram the thing, guess what? You let the smoke out here. I got away with it for quite a while here without this actually happening, but my luck eventually ran out. The code that does the scrolling text that you saw at the beginning of the video essentially has no dead time in it at all. I update the whole panel, and then I'm figuring out what's the next data that I've got to shift out, and then I'm sending that out right away. So there really isn't any dead time. I'm constantly flipping dots. So I'm spending a fair percentage of my time in that 200 microsecond loop there. And eventually I came along and tried to do a code update at the wrong time and let the smoke out. Now it turns out there was an easy solution, and I very nearly included it on my circuit board, but I was rushing at the end and left it off. What would have saved me is simply a pair of pull-up resistors on these two enable lines here. So pull up to 5 volts on the row enable line, and a pull up to 5 volts here on the column enable line. And I had put them in initially. And then you'll recall from before that there's actually room for two different controllers on this board. You can have the Arduino Nano, or you can have an ESP8266. And you decide which one of those you want to use, and you plug that one in. Now, the Nano operates on 5 volts, and the ESP operates on 3.3 volts. So somewhere in there has to be some level shifters going on, because the 595 shift registers all want 5 volts. So I need a level shifter to go from 3.3 up to 5 when I'm running on the ESP. And I read deep into the data sheet on that thing, and it warns against using pull-up resistors. It says, don't use them, but if you actually have to, you know, make them, I think, above 50K here. And the sensible thing would have been to include them on the circuit board. And if it turns out that they cause trouble, I could have removed them. But I was in a big rush. I wanted to get the thing out the door, get my circuit boards back. What I end up doing is just taking those pull-up resistors out. And so what I've had to do on the circuit board here is solder in a couple of resistors on the backside just so I don't get bit by this again. And so again, I'm going to show you on the bench what happens when you don't have that there, and then how adding them fixes that problem. All right, so let's turn the camera around and we'll show you some things on the bench. Okay, I've taken the road driver board off the flip dot panel and put it on the bench here, and I've broken out 4 pairs of lines from the connector going over to the breadboard here, where I've got some red LEDs and some green LEDs. The red LEDs are lit when I'm driving the high side, and the green LEDs light up when I'm driving the low side. There's a program on the Arduino that's simply going to cycle through all 4 bit possibilities, 00, 01, 10, 11. Now, to demonstrate that the diodes are actually going to do something here, what I've done is I've removed the 4 diodes corresponding to those 4 pairs from the board. You can see where the empty pads are, where the diodes used to be. So as I cycle through all 4 possibilities, you'll notice that I really do get the case where I have both red and green lit at the same time. So if this board were on the flip dot panel, that would be a short circuit. So to show you that the diodes really do prevent that, I'm going to unplug from those 4 positions and move over to these 4 positions where the diodes are still present on the board here. So as I cycle through the possibilities here, you'll notice I no longer have the simultaneous red and green situation. It turns into just lighting up the greens only, just the low side drive. So that shows that those diodes really do prevent that situation from happening here. Okay, now the last thing I want to talk about is the trouble you might get into if you don't have a pull-up resistor on the enable line of the shift registers here. Whenever an Arduino first starts up, or when you press the reset button, all of the GPIO lines become inputs. So now, instead of actively driving that enable line high or low, it's just floating. And it's going to be up to the chip how it interprets that. It might interpret that as low, in other words, still enabled. It might interpret that as high or disabled. It's effectively random here. So a further feature of the program on the Nano right now is that the first thing that it does, before it does anything else, it simply goes into a delay loop for 5 seconds. That's before it configures any of the GPIOs as outputs, before it tries to shift any data. Now, that simulates what happens when you click the program button in the Arduino IDE, because that causes a reset, and then several seconds will elapse as it transfers the program, and then the new program will start to execute. So if you were actively driving some solenoids, you had, for instance, high on the row and low on the column, and click the program button in the IDE at that inopportune time, it may well get stuck in that state for several seconds. And that's going to, of course, start to draw far too much current. You're going to let the smoke out. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to wait for the green state to come around, and then I'm going to hit the reset button here. Now, one of 2 things could happen. It might get stuck in that state, which is the bad thing. It might also not. It might immediately light up the reds, which is what happens when the chip is no longer enabled. So let's see what happens here. Boom. Oh, we got unlucky. So notice the green LEDs are still lit, and they're going to stay lit for about 5 seconds. And then we're going to restart the program here. So if you had been actively driving solenoids here and clicked the program button in the IDE like I did a few days ago, and everything aligned here, you're going to let some smoke out. So to demonstrate that having pull-up resistors can fix that, I've got some resistors soldered to the back of the board here. There's one for the row driver and one for the column driver, and I'm going to connect that to the 5 volts. So now there are proper pull-ups in place. And now, next time I click the reset button, it should immediately snap to the red LEDs on. So what that means is, on the reset now, the pull-up pulled the enable line high, which disables the chips, which sets all the outputs to zero, which turns on the high output. And remember, that's okay, because the same thing is also happening on the column board. So all of the row lines go high, all of the column lines go high. As far as the coils are concerned, they're not energized. So having that pull-up resistor is a real good idea. It keeps the smoke inside the chips where it belongs here.